Hi everybody, my name is Rupa, working as assistant professor in Chapel Engineering College in the Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering. I'm dealing the subject renewable energy source, and today's topic is torque coefficient equations. So before we see some equations from this, lambda is equal to Vt by Vi. That is equal to R omega by Vi. In place of R, I am substituting the remaining and substituting the in Tmax. Tmax is equal to rho A Vi square Vi lambda by 2 omega. That implies Pa into lambda by omega. Here Pa is called as power in the wind, and shaft power is Pt tau into omega. So now from this equation, Pt is equal to, we know that Cp into Pa, and using 1 and 6 equations, equation 7 total equation above equation becomes Cp into Pa is equal to Ct Tmax into omega. And it becomes Cp Pa is equal to Ct into Tmax into omega. We can write Pa into lambda by omega. So this denominator omega and numerator omega gets cancelled. So this omega Pa by lambda. Pa into lambda by omega. So this omega and numerator omega cancels. Remaining Pa into lambda will be remained. So Cp, Pa, Pa gets cancelled. Cp is equal to lambda into Ct. So Ct is equal to, we know that from Bell's coefficient, Bell's criteria, the maximum value of Cp we can reach is 0.593 only. So in ideal case, we can take Cmax. Ct maximum is equal to 0.593 by lambda. Okay, so finally we get the torque coefficient Ct. It is numerically equal to, Ct is equal to Cp by omega. Here we know that omega is the rotational speed radians per second. It is the rotational speed and units are radians per second. Okay. So the machines which are having high speeds, these are slightly higher. These are having slightly higher maximum Cp. But if they have higher Cp, they have lower Ct. Okay. So this is particular for starting. This is particularly, we can observe this point at startings. High solidity machines, which are the machines which are having high solidity, these are generally having highest starting torques than running torques. Okay, so if a machine is having high solidity, means it is having high starting torque than the running torque. But while the starting torques of the low solidity machines are even, these are even lower than the quite low running torques also. So these starting torques are much lower, and the choice of the rotor, what rotor we have to choose, this is based mainly on the pump's load characteristics. Okay, so the water pump load characteristics decides what is the choice of our rotor. If you take example as a positive displacement pump, such as piston pumps. Okay, so if you go to plan for piston pumps used in the boreholes, it has to be having a high starting torques. That is, it demands high starting torques, and running torque is not required for this. It only demands for high starting torques than the running torques. So here high solidity rotor is essential. Okay, so this value, we are using this high solidity rotor, we have to use some method of unloading the rotor process, because to it because this helps in starting to start the rotor by itself. So we have to use some unloading rotor methods to start the rotor at the startings. And other type, suppose electrical generators, these needs little torque only at start. Okay, so at the drill holes, if you want to drill a hole, high starting torques are required. But when coming to the electrical generators, these require only little torques at the startings. Okay, so at the running, but they have to be managed with the running torques of constant speeds. Okay, so they demand this running torques, and they do not require high starting torques. Okay, so while at running, they need high speeds. So for this, we are using high speed low soldering rotor. So the application we are using, these will be depending, these will be deciding the what type of rotor we are choosing. So there will be high solidity rotors and low solidity rotors. If you use high solidity rotors, we have high starting torques. If you use low solding rotors, we have low starting torques, and running torque is vice versa to them. If you have high starting torques, we have low running torques. If you have low starting torques, we have high running torques, like that. So now we choose the number of blades. How many blades we have to choose for a rotor to design a windmill? Now we will discuss. So actually, wind turbines have been built up to 6 propeller type blades. Okay, so we can go up to a maximum extent of 6 propeller type blades. This type of shape is called as propeller. So 6 propeller type of blades, we can go up to a maximum level, but 2 or 3 are most commonly used. Okay, windmill with 2 or 3 are most commonly used. And if you can use a one blade with a balancing counterweight on the other hand, okay, so that one blade, it should have some balancing counterweight so that it will be stiff standing there. If you are using this balancing counterweight, it has more advantages, including what are the advantages we will see if you go to more number of blades, and if you have one number blade. Okay, so what are the advantages? Means lower weight we can get. One blade is lower weight, and cost wise also we can decrease to a lower extent, and simple controllers can be used. Okay, so these are the advantages. What are the advantages? Once I am telling, weight, cost, and simplicity. So these three are the advantages. If you go on increasing the blades, we cut off these advantages. But at the starting time, it requires high wind speeds. This is the only disadvantage of using one blade. Okay, at the time of starting only, we require high wind speeds. So if at all the wind speed, the rotating wind speed is acquired, only the blade will be rotating. And for this one blade, what is the other disadvantage is, means vibration and other forces are also large when compared to this 2 or 3 more blades when you are using. Okay, so using one blade, there are 3 types of disadvantage. We need high wind speeds at the time of starting, because to rotate that one blade, we require high wind speeds, and vibrations will also be more, and other forces can also be too large to damage the machine. Okay, so turbines with 3 blades have been used in several WEC, wind energy conversion machines. Okay, so if you of these three blades, we can avoid the vibrations experienced with the two blade rotors. So in one blade and two blade rotors, there are more chances of vibrations experienced by the windmills, but we can overcome this disadvantage if you use three blades, because these vibrations, these are related to yawning. Yawning means you discussed this term before, turning, nothing but simply saying turning. So these vibrations that are related to the yawning of the rotor, what the vibrations we are getting is, these are related to the yawning. But these yawning problems can be overcome by controlling the yaw rate, WAY rate. Okay, so this rate is mentioned by the windmill, so we should not exceed this yaw rate. And these two blades, sorry, three blades, these are also less in cost to fabricate in large sizes. If you go for large sizes, we can opt for three blades which are less in cost, and these are capable of operating with a high tip speed ratio, TSR. And these two blade machines also, we can get high tip speed ratios. These are the number of blades. Depending upon the application also, we can choose the number of blades. Next one, blade design. So how will be the shape of the blade and how it is twisted and designed, we will see now. So blade design, this is a design type. What is this design type called? Means it is airfoil type. Okay, so this wind turbine blades have an airfoil type cross section, and it is having variable pitch. Okay, these are slightly twisted from the outer tip to the roots. Slightly twisted from the outer tip to the roots. Root means here where the blade is attached to the hub here. The blade will be attached to the hub here. This point is called as root. Because this twist is taken to reduce the tendency for the rotor to stall. For decreasing the stalling purpose, we are using this twist. In some few devices, these blades have constant chord lengths. This is the chord. Okay, so this is the leading edge. So in few devices, if you observe that this blade has a constant chord length, that is, the chord length is, it is the distance from edge to the other. From edge to the other. Okay. So if you take this blade design as narrow at the tip, this is the tip, this is the edge, root or edge, right? So if you take narrow at the tips, at this part, if you take this type of narrow design, the better performance will be obtained by this blade. So that is the reason why you are taking blades narrow at the tip parts here. Okay, so this is the cross section of airfoil type wind rotor blade. Next one, this is the windmill blade as an airfoil. Okay, this is the windmill blade as an airfoil. So here we can see the force here. See, effective wind. This is the effective wind direction, and this is the effective wind direction here. This is the leading edge or root, and this is the tip, and this is the rotation motion like this. This is the forward thrust, and this is the final thrust, equivalent thrust. This is the wind flowing like this here, and this is wind due to rotation. Here, this is rotation. R O T A T A O N. Spelling mistake is there. And effective wind. This is effective wind force. Okay. So if you see this figure, we see that force that propels the blades of a conventional windmill comes from the cord. Here comes from the cord of the airfoil. Okay, so these are being tilted away in the direction of motion. Okay, so this is the direction of motion, and these are tilted away in the direction of the motion. This one, cord. Okay, so the motion which is causing the wind due to motion here, wind due to motion is the rotation of the blades, is the direction of rotation of the blades. At the tip of the blades of the modern, suppose in modern wind turbines, at the tip of the blades, the velocity is assumed to be about 6 times the wind's velocity. Okay, the modern designs are like that, that the tip velocity is having 6 times the velocity of the wind. So if you are having this much, about 6 times more, these blades are set flat. Okay, these blades are set flat at a small angles with the plane of the rotation, and these are almost at right angles. These are almost at right angles to the direction of the wind. See, if you see this, this is the horizontal axis, this is the vertical axis. These are kept vertically. That means the wind action is in vertical. Okay, so the wind action is always at right angles to the direction. At the so this effective wind will be approaching from ahead to the leading edge. Okay, so from this direction, the wind effective wind will be there from tip to leading edge. Okay, so other parts of blade between the tip and axle of the velocity and the ideal set of airfoil, these are greater angle to the planes of rotations. Okay, so ideally, if you see that blade, what is the this blade? What you are taking? It has to be twisted. It is a compulsory point, but due to the because of the construction difficulties arising in this, this is all not ways. This is always not achieved. So we cannot twist the blade at all the angles, because in large two-blade wind turbines, if you take these blades, these are much difficult for large turbines for twisting, because the design did not accept this twisting, and there will be some. Chances of become delicating at the time of twisting. Okay, so this is not always achieved in the large machines. This twisting process is not achieved always. If you take large two-blade wind turbines, these blades are inclined at small angles. These angles, the small angles at which the blades are inclined, these are called as coming angles to the vertical. Okay. Coming angles to the verticals. You see next slide. So see, in large two blades, the angles that are inclined at a small angle, these are called as coming angles to the vertical. So this, if you take this design will be decreasing the bending load on the root of the blades. And it decreases the danger of fouling the support tower under service wind conditions. Okay, so in very large rotors, it consists of single piece mounted at the midpoint, and there is no coning angle like that. But the fundamental problem in wind turbine design, it is the fundamental problem. What is the fundamental problem means? It is the design to allow for the many forces. Okay, so while operation, during normal operations, this wing allows almost all the forces that are in the wing, and it will be what, taking all the forces into it, grasping all the forces, and by observing this all the forces, it has to withstand. Okay, this is the fundamental problems arising in the windmills. All the forces will be attacked at one time only, and the windmill has to withstand these forces. In additional, vibration stress will also be there with this force also. Okay, so these vibrational stresses are resulting from at the time of rotations. When the rotation of the windmill starts, these vibration stresses will be start. There are external forces also called as extraneous forces. So there are several extraneous forces other than the force in the wind and the vibration stresses. These external extraneous forces will be arising from the wind turbulence. So what are the various forces we will see now? First one is wind turbulence, and second one is directional changes in the wind. Third one is variations of wind speed with height, and fourth one is wind gusts. Fifth one is gravitational forces, and last one is pressure of the tower, etc. Not completed, but these are the main forces that are overcome by the windmills. So the blades which we are taking in the windmills, these should be constructed properly and more rugged, and these should be attached to the hub in such a manner to withstand all these forces. All the mentioned forces should be withstanded by the wind blade. If you take the wind blade in an aerodynamic design, so this aerodynamic design has high performance. Okay, so to withstand all these forces, this aerodynamic is having high performance, and it is having rotor adequate strength to tolerate all these forces coming in the wings. And we know that wind power of a rotor, this increases with the square of the, this wind power of the rotor, this will be increasing with the square of the swept diameter. Swept diameter is the area the windmill is rotating, swepting the wind. Okay, so this increases the power of the rotor. The power of the rotor will be increasing with the square of the swept diameter. So P is equal to A square, increasing A times diameter square times the diameter, it will be increasing the power. So, but although it is increasing, we cannot go on increasing the power because there is a practical limit to the size. Okay, to the size there is a practical limit. So we will see the variations that is going on. See, first, at the first place, in the first place, the mass of the blade will be increasing. Here arrow symbol upwards means increasing, and arrow symbol downwards means decreasing. Okay, so in first, the mass of the blade will be increasing rapidly with the dimensions. So in the first place, what will be increasing? Mass of the blade will be increasing with increase in the dimensions. So as a result, what will happen? The wind power available per unit mass. Okay, so the wind power which is available per unit mass, if you consider, we are considering this per only unit mass only. Okay, so this unit mass, wind power available per unit mass will be decreasing. Okay, as the dimensions of the rotor are increasing. So as the dimensions or diameter of the rotor are increasing, the wind power available per unit mass will be decreasing. So in a unit mass, the power will be decreasing as we increase the diameter or dimensions. Okay, so this results in the tip speed ratio tends to decreasing correspondingly. So as the wind power available per unit mass will be decreasing as we increase the dimensions of the rotor, the tip speed ratio will be decreasing. So furthermore, if you continue this, if this tip speed ratio decreases, this results in wind drag forces generally increase with the blade size. So as the blade size increases, wind drag forces also increases. So the limiting dimensions, we have to limit the dimensions of the blade size. Okay, so what are the disadvantages? Means if you increase the dimensions, mass will be increasing. If you increase the mass up to 1 meter, one per unit mass, up to one volume of mass, sorry, one if you take a one more 1 meter, one per unit mass, sorry, if you take per unit mass, the wind power will be decreasing. So as the wind power decreases, TSR decreases. Okay, so these all decreases, so drag forces increases. If the drag forces increases, what is the disadvantage? We have to always increase the lift forces in order to rotate a windmill. But here we are getting drag forces increases. That means the drag forces increases means the speed will be decreasing. Okay, if the speed decreases, no power. Okay, so the wind power will be increasing as the square of the swept diameter, but it has some limits. In practical, the limiting dimensions depend upon the design and constructional materials also. Okay, so these two also give the limiting dimensions. These depend upon the design and construction materials, but the maximum practical diameter of it, suppose if you take a two blade rotor, it may be in the range of 90 to 100 meters. What is the size of the two blade rotor? Large size means 90 to 110 meters. So in order to provide both lightweight and adequate strength, we have to provide both. So in order to provide both lightweight and adequate strength, aircraft industry techniques are used in connecting with airplanes, and helicopter propellers have been drawn upon these designs. Okay, so what we are using exactly in the aircraft design, nothing but these helicopter propellers. If you observe the helicopter propellers, these are both lightweight and these are having high strengths. Okay, so same connecting with the airplanes and the helicopter propellers, if you observe connecting air places and helicopter propellers, same design is used in our windmills also. Okay, so these wind turbines are designed on the same. So for if you take in small rotors, the blades can be made of laminated wood. Okay, small rotors blades can be made of laminated wood, or possibly these are covered with a skin of aluminium. Only with the skin of aluminium, not all the aluminium is used as a metal. Only the skin of this wood is covered with the aluminium. And rotors up to 34 meters in diameter, they have been fabricated from plastic reinforced with glass fibers. Okay, so for small wood is used, and medium 34 meters diameter having rotors, a plastic reinforced with glass fiber is used. Okay, and more conventional aircraft type blades, these are usually made up of aluminium or with some aluminium alloy also they can be made, because this consists of long central span with the ribs at intervals. Okay, so ribs means what we are having in the part at our lungs part, ribs will be covering the lungs at some intervals, at some gaps. So like this only, they consist of long central span with ribs at intervals. These are covered with the aluminium skin. Okay, these all whips are covered with the aluminium skins. Okay, and the largest, very largest rotor blades, these have been made of steel. Okay, so for large rotor blades, very large rotor blades, steel is used for making it. So this provides adequate strength. Steel provides adequate strength. Next one, yaw controls. Okay, the area of the wind streams which is swept by the wind, which is the areas of the wind streams that are swept by the wind turbine, is maximum. When will be maximum? When the blade flashes into the wind. Okay, so this is achieved by some using control arrangements. Okay, so in this control arrangements, wind direction changes, a motor rotates the turbine slowly above the vertical axis because it has to face the blades into the wind. Okay, so for control system this is done. For localities with the wind in one direction, if you take a locality which is having the wind in one direction, only one direction wind is blowing there in this location, so the design of the turbine can be greatly simplified at those locations. In these locations we are taking a rotor, it can be fixed orientation with swept area which is perpendicular to the wind director, predominant wind director. Okay, so here if you take in this location where the wind is in one direction, rotor can be fixed with a swept area that is perpendicular to the predominant wind director. So the wind is moving in one direction only, so that one direction wind, we are taking that direction as x axis suppose, and this rotor is fixed in y axis. So if you fix this like this, we call it as yaw fixed. Okay, this is a yaw fixed machine. There are two types of machine, yaw fixed and yaw active. So if you take the rotor perpendicular to the wind direction, it is called, if you fix the rotor perpendicular to the wind direction, it is called as yaw fixed. That is, it cannot be rotate around a vertical axis perpendicular to the wind stream. But most wind turbines, these are taken as yaw active machines. So as the wind direction changes, they will track the changing direction of the wind. Okay, if you take fixed direction, the windmill will be rotating in that direction only. So what we have fixed before, it should be rotating in that direction only. But if you come to this yaw active type of machine, depending upon the wind direction, sometimes the wind will be rotating. Though the wind is rotating in one direction, sometimes it can change in directions. Okay, so some hours it can be changed from east to west. In some hours, in some times it will be from west to east. So depending upon the wind direction, this blade will be changing the direction. Okay, so this blade, this rotor will be tracking the changing direction of the wind. So in this case, the motor rotates the turbine slowly above the vertical or yaw axis. Okay, so this will be turning above the vertical or yaw axis to face the blades into the wing. Okay, in order to face the blades into the wing, this is rotating. In this type of yaw active, the area of the wind stream swept by the wind will be maximum. Okay, in this active machine, the area of the wind stream swept by the wind will become maximum here. Okay, so in smaller turbines, this yaw action controlled, it is controlled by a tail vane. Okay, in smaller turbines only the action controlling, yeah, action controlling is done by tail vane. So this is, we can see this in American pumping windmill. This is the example, small turbines example is American pumping windmill. In this, the control is done by tail vane. So coming to the large machines, the air control, the if you consider the large machines, a servo mechanism operated by a wind direction sensor, this controls the air motor that keeps the turbine properly oriented.